Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Tony Aiuto. I'm with the Bazel team in New York over in Chelsea Market. And today we're going to talk about Bazel and S-bombs. You can think of it as a continuation of the talk that Miha did this morning about Google's open source security initiatives. And we fit in there because Bazel and salsa together is delicious. And we're at the salsa level one, having a provable build. So what's supply chain security about? I mean, you do code reviews, right? You want to protect against insider attacks or accepting malicious third-party code that seems harmless. But do you actually know what goes inside your products, what you ship to people, what you use to build them? And of course, you all remember the Log4j incident, right? And even if you don't, the US government remembers the Log4j incident. That's why we can't have nice things now. And, you know, they want everyone to do something about it. There are 10 of you in the room who really care about this talk, but I can assure you that the SVPs of every company you work for really cares about the results here today, because it's going to allow them to continue to sell to the government. So what are S-bombs and how does Bazel fit? An S-bomb is a software bill of materials, and it's basically a list of what went into your product. And at the minimal level, that is the packages and the versions of each. I use curl at version 1.5.2. It's actually 5.7 right now, but it's that. It can include more. There's a rich set of things they'd like you to have. You could have the URL you downloaded it from, the checksum of it from that time, the contact information for the package, separate ones for the package author and the maintainer and the distributor, because they're all sort of different jobs. You can include permanent URLs to vulnerability databases. But that's just one aspect. That's just what I linked in my product. You could also say, well, how I built it. You know, I compile with CLang. Should I include the S-bomb for CLang? And the answer is no, not unless someone asks you for that. But eventually people will ask for that. And it can go as far as the infrastructure you build it on. That's that salsa level four that Mahi printed at. So all you vendors of RBE systems, someday your customers are going to say, can you give me the manifest of how you built your services so I can show my customers that it was built securely? Bazel fits this world really well because it's really good at knowing exactly what was both linked into your code and used as a tool or referred to as a data dependency. So we have a great opportunity to produce an accurate S-bomb. So you as Bazel users are actually really strategically well-placed to do something good for your company that they're going to care about. And you're way ahead of the ugly truth of reality that most companies do this by like grepping through their third-party code, seeing what they have, throwing it into a spreadsheet, and having some lawyer in the compliance department bless it and go, yeah, okay, I think we can tell the government we use that. How it works? It's almost going to be surprisingly easy. We're going to piggyback on an initiative we started a few years ago with improving the attestations for open source licensing and the logic around that. So there's a repository rules license that implements this all roughly in StarLark, so we don't have Bazel extensions explicitly for it. On third-party packages in your top-level build file, you have a license declaration and or a package info declaration, and they're just simple targets. They look something like this. There is an attribute for package, default package metadata, that contains a list of targets, and these targets are just rules that really don't do anything. They just provide a provider to wrap up the information contained in them. Licenses typically have things like, I'm declaring myself as I'm under Apache 2, you can use me freely, and here's my copyright notice, and there's a pointer to the file that contains the license text. And a package info rule, right there it only says, Log4j at version 2.17, which is the good one, so you can tell your manager, no, I reused the good one, it's safe. But this is going to be expanded. We could put in all those other things that I talked about, just didn't do it, so it fits on a slide. Once you can get your third-party code, and even your own code annotated this way, you'll add a rule like this somewhere in your build. And for Bazel, you know, the package we build is really Bazel bin, no JDK, and that one gets distributed. But I have a generate SBOM rule around that, which produces the SBOM. Similarly, there's a license, check license rule that takes the target, and here we want to produce multiple outputs because you care about licenses in one file, and you need the copyright notices somewhere else, and you want to get an audit report somewhere else. But it's the same tooling doing both and gathering them and just printing the results in different ways. And right now, you know, for Bazel, I can print something like this. This is not what we would ever ship because it should be in JSON or XML, but I don't want to show JSON or XML on a slide. So I'm just showing you the kind of thing you produce with document names and well-defined identifiers like SPDX ID and SPDX version. So I made it sound like it's easy and all done. There's a bunch of things to do. Well, how do we get those package attestations in there? The answer is we depend on a lot of things that don't have them yet. And it's especially true in the C++ world. You depend on something from Git, and it's got a configure file and literally nothing else. You bring it in with an HTTP archive rule and throw in a build file. If you're writing your own build file for it, that's a chance for you to put it in. If you're using a repository that might have a build file but doesn't have package rules, we've developed a technique to let those be spliced in during repository loading so that we take whatever information is available, like the Maven POM coordinate or the URL for an HTTP archive, and can turn that into a minimal package info rule. There's another fun aspect of this where, you know, I may have a package that's Bazel ready and I declare it's under Apache 2 for the licensing. Most large companies don't trust me to do it right. So I know Google, we scan the source that we download with our own license scanner and say, oh yeah, you got some GPL code over there. It's not really pure Apache 2. Other companies I know look at the downloaded URLs and they've had individuals actually audit the files and say what should really be attributed to it. Final detail to get right is standards. There is no clear SBOM standard yet. They're competing things. One is SPDX, one is Cyclone DX. They are mostly convertible from one to the other, but your organization has to pick what's right for you, and the Bazel world shouldn't. And this leads to some immediate future work that I know we're going to be doing. The first is to add interoperability into the existing repository rules. So JVM external, foreign CC, HTTP archive, the Node NPM, the Node.js things, and I'm sure there are others. Oh, the whole Golang import system. This is a toolkit and not, you know, an end product, because, you know, my lawyers are different from your lawyers and are different from your lawyers. And in the end of the day, you're going to have to satisfy your compliance teams. So we're going to provide a lot of well-lit paths in how you do various things, but each of you is going to end up doing something slightly different to make your customer and your regulatory environment happy. I mean, I can speak a little about what I think is happening in the United States. In Europe, it could be entirely different. So we'll have to make room for that. There are dozens of different formats. Some people are going to want binary readable things. Something people are going to want PDFs that are, you know, printed on paper and given to someone, but not useful to anyone. The thing I'm most excited about in the future is being able to do much richer graphs of your build. So what I'd like to get to is a point where when you declare a rule, you can annotate an attribute with what kind of relationship it means, something we link in versus a data file I need to run my tool versus, oh, it's a configuration file we're going to ship with the product, but the user gets to override it versus a shared library. And the SBOM standards committees are all defining these kind of relationships. If we can put those into the rule declarations, we can emit a build graph that has that. So we're able to tell you, yeah, I used CLang to generate my code. You know, that's one risk assessment. And I link in libc. That's a different assessment, even though libc comes possibly with CLang. You can follow along all of this in various ways. Rules license is where all the code lives and the PRs happen. There is a mailing list, Bazel SSC at bazel.build, which anyone is welcome to join. That link should get you there. The code in Bazel is pretty minimal. You know, it's just loading the package and using a few rules. The standards groups are spdx.dev, salsa.dev, and I believe it may be dxcyclone or cyclone.dx.dev. I should have put the link in, but I can't edit the slide at this time. So thank you for being here, everyone. I'll be in the back for questions if you have them. It's been fun to be here. I hope you enjoy the last hour of the show. Thank you.